Colbert sought information for a living. That is to say that ever since he returned from Korea, after having served with the armed forces, he had been working as a private investigator in Montreal. William Hamilton, a rich industrialist, had gotten in touch with him regarding a simple vandalism issue. Nothing to write home about. Not worth hiring a private eye either, just so he can drive for hours on rough roads. But that's how it had always been. The client pays, Carl gets it done. Military training had made him a very punctual man. Being late to his meeting with Hamilton was out of the question. They had set up to meet at the general store, his client's business. Well, actually, the entire village had William Hamilton's name written all over it. Or snowed in, it was customary around these parts to close them off. But it was also customary to ignore those signs entirely and drive there anyway. Diligent in his work, always carried his log on him, in which he scribbled down thoughts and leads alike during the course of his investigations. The Polaroid, Carl's long-standing and faithful ally, has seen its share of husbands caught red-handed cheating. There's always something out there waiting to be snapped away. Hamilton never mentioned a road-blocking barrier. Why was it needed here in the back of beyond? That would, however, be a mystery for another day. Carl had waited long enough for someone to come and raise it. Still not a soul in sight. There was no point in waiting any longer. Carl had to figure this one out by himself. Hamilton is waiting for Carl in the general store. It was time for him to get down to business. Hamilton enjoyed a lavish country house built in the very heart of the northern forests, not too far from here. Carl was dying to stretch his legs, but he had to stay focused on the task at hand. The local populace was divided when it came to the affluent man. Some saw a wealthy philanthropist dedicated to improving the region's economy. Others, an aging Englishman who would do anything to further his fortunes. And those ones hated him enough to go on about scheming against him. Hamilton had recently acquired a few local businesses. But the last straw was the reopening of a mine, which gave rise to a wave of protests and threats from the Cree people. Now wasn't a good time to wander about. Hamilton was still out there. Carl was dying to stretch his legs, but he had to stay focused on the task at hand. Given these circumstances, Carl reckoned that a good number of people must be feeling compelled to oppose Hamilton in one way or another. So far, only the industrialist's house had been a target, but soon enough, Carl thought, the target would become the man himself. Carl needed to get out of there. The cold and the pain required urgent care. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. The driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. Even better than he had hoped, Carl Faubert had succeeded once more and was now on his way to new adventures. cold was burning Carl. He would not hold up much longer. He had to warm himself. It was a small, locked box engraved with the letters WH. Carl thought about taking it. Nothing was to be left to chance. Carl, like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. Scratches did not stop Carl. His mother would be so proud. Military training had made him a very punctual man. Being late to his meeting with Hamilton was out of the question. Spread out on a few acres of untouched forest, bellowing caribou, everlasting snow, and undefiled lakes. The Manistan region was no tourist hub. It was said to have been populated for millennia by Cree people, and ever since the industrial era, by the metal mining industry.
Oui, la tentation était forte de se dégourdir les jambes encore un peu, mais Carl tenait bon. Il restait concentré sur son objectif. par bonheur, le magasin n'était plus très loin. Carl commençait à craindre la panne d'essence. Carl se souvint, non sans courage, de ses cours de survie dans la nature. Les loups jamais n'approchent les lieux habités. À moins que ce ne soit les ours. Il y avait de la haine dans la place. Tout le monde dans le village ne se portait pas dans son cœur. Le magasin et ses alentours n'avaient pas livré tous leurs secrets, pressentait Carl. Il n'aimait pas passer à côté de quelque chose. Carl était habitué aux choses étranges. Mais une glace comme ça, un iceberg sorti du sol, il n'en avait jamais vu avant. Carl se demandait s'il devait endurer encore longtemps le froid qui lui piquait la peau. Chaque semaine, le laitier devait passer remplir les bouteilles. À sentir le lait frais, il était bel et bien passé cette semaine. « Quelque chose est tombé dans le fond de la boîte. Carl n'eut aucun mal à reconnaître son employeur. Il avait été assassiné. Il ne fallait pas être détective pour le constater. Mais il fallait être détective pour noter que le tueur se tenait tout près, que le coup avait été porté sans que la victime ne se défende. Carl sentit alors un frisson le traverser, une peur effroyable l'envahir. Si Hamilton était mort, qui allait donc payer? On aurait dit qu'une explosion avait soufflé dehors. Comme le savait Carl, Gilles Lachance tenait le magasin général. Ça faisait de lui un employé de Hamilton. Un employé fort mécontent, comme Carl pouvait en juger.
La tempête frappait tout sans distinction. Carl constata sans surprise la ligne hors service.